And by the time we were able to publish it was actually right around the same time Kepler, I think, ran out of fuel. So it's like 10 right. years had passed mm-hmm. and we were just now confirming the first ever planet a decade later.
Have you ever wondered what it's like to discover a brand new world? In the last 3 decades, we've found over 5,000 planets outside our solar system called exoplanets. I'm Dr. Jessie Christensen, the lead scientist at the NASA Exoplanet Archive. This is Explore Exoplanets, The Discoverers, a series where I interview the brilliant minds behind the discovery of brand new planets. Hello, everybody. If you're watching this on YouTube, you can also listen to it as a podcast. Head to Apple Podcasts or Google Play and take us on your morning commute. If you're listening to us, you can also watch us on YouTube, where you'll find some bonus graphics to help explain what my guest and I are talking about. Speaking of which, welcome everyone. We're joined by Dr. Ashley Chontos, who's the Henry Norris Russell Postdoctoral Fellow at Princeton University. I'm a terrible astronomer. I had to go look up who Henry Norris Russell was. And then I was like, oh, Hertzsprung-Russell. Got it. Amazing. So welcome, Ashley. Thank you so much for coming on the show.
Thank you so much for having me, Jessie. Glad to be here.
Okay, so physically, where are you located right now?
I am actually in Princeton at the moment.
It was very muggy and hot and awful when I was there last week, so I hope it's cooled off a bit.
It has actually. It's beautiful. It's like ideal weather. We had our first softball game last night, so I'm really glad it wasn't last week, but it's like 60s. Yeah. It gets into the 50s at night, but last week was horrid.
Yeah, last week it was in the 80s and 1,000,000% humidity. Yeah. It was a lot. So you're in Princeton and you're a postdoctoral fellow. So tell us how you got to be a postdoctoral fellow at Princeton.
Yeah, it's kind of a little bit random. I believe that, so how do we start? Okay, I had like an entirely different career for 8 years. And then one day I decided that I just wanted to go back to school and I really loved science and math. Mm-hmm. And I applied to a school, naively assuming that they had some engineering program. They did not. So I went to my guidance counselor and said, what should I do? And they're like, well, I guess the closest thing is physics. And I was like, never heard of it. Cool. Let's do it. And then in my junior year, I ended up running into someone called Bruce McIntosh, who is one of the most amazing astronomers I've ever met. Mm-hmm. And it was through his internship that he taught me like grad school, that you can get paid to go to school. Mm-hmm. I learned I had been doing it the wrong way the whole time. And so then I applied for astronomy programs and it kind of just like was this like random chain of events. And now I'm just really glad to be here. So.
Fantastic. Yeah, Bruce was a guest on our show previously. So for people listening, go check out Bruce McIntosh's episodes. As Ashley said, one of the greatest astronomers, and we were lucky to have him on the show. He's very busy. So very random walk. So let's put you back maybe when you first meet Bruce, right? So you've had your other career, you've come back to school, you've done physics, Bruce introduces you astronomy. Did you ever think that you would find a planet around another star?
Absolutely not. We were actually at the time doing simulations for what was at the time called the W-First AFTA, which has since been renamed the Roman Telescope and is now very much in the forefront. And as you probably spoke with Bruce, he does a lot with direct imaging. So we're doing a lot of simulations for the coronagraph instrument that will be on board. But so just like making fake planets and not ever thinking that I would find a real one.
I built my whole Kepler career making fake planets. So don't worry about that. Fake planets are where it's at.
They're important too.
Okay. So tell us about how you discovered your planet, Kepler 1658b.
Oh boy. I hope we have enough time for that. This is a really fun story.
Sure.
Of course I'm biased, but this is my first year of grad school, so this is back in 2016. Mm-hmm. It was my first research project, well, aside from undergrad research. And my PhD advisor, Dan Kuber, had suggested that there was this basically re-release of Kepler data. And no one had really gone through it to look for what we call astroseismology, or like these, we can detect like brightness fluctuations of stars, which helps us to better characterize a star. And then if they have planets, that's great because we can recharacterize them too. Mm-hmm. So I was not looking for planets at all. And I think I've since spoken to him about this. Like, he actually thought that nothing would even come out of this. And it was just like, so I'll never forget it. Again, first year grad student, knew nothing about Kepler, the Kepler naming conventions, like what a KOI was.
That's a Kepler object of interest.
Yeah. And I went in there and I was really excited. I thought I found like a few new detections that were not known or published at the time. And the KIC 386-1595, this phone number that will forever live rent free in my head.
It's just burned into your brain now.
Yeah. Or KOI-4. So I showed him the seismic detection and he was like, yeah, I can actually believe that. And then we went on to ExoFOP, which is a nice resource for people that follow up exoplanets. And we looked up the kick and he saw KOI-4. And I'll never forget this because he just went dead silent, swiveled in his chair, went back to his computer and was just like madly typing on his computer. And I'm like, what? Like, what did I do?
What happened?
No idea what. So he had like, you know, spent some however many minutes going through and he's like, I think we could be onto something. And so then he reached out to Dave Latham, who was kind of a pioneer in the field. So it was like particularly exciting. He was able to turn, you know, the Trace Telescope to this, to Kepler or KY4 and follow it up. And like within a week, we had a detection and it was just, it was by total accident, basically.
So let me get this straight. Did you rediscover the transits of KOI-4 in this astroseismology work, or were you finding an astroseismic signal and then later realizing it was a KOI?
Yeah, actually, so that's a good point. To take a step back, in the early Kepler days when they were characterizing stars, they used broadband photometry, which was really good for thousands and thousands of stars, but not great on like a single individual basis. So the star was actually, so it's a little bit hotter than the sun, about 6,000 Kelvin. But it, at the time, they thought it was around the same size as the sun. So the transiting feature that they saw around it, which also produced a secondary eclipse, is not like they thought it was a Neptune-sized planet. And Neptune-sized planets are too small to create like a visible secondary eclipse.
Oh, okay. So they thought it was a false positive.
Exactly. So they thought it was a background eclipsing binary. And then what happened was the seismic analysis actually said that the star was three times larger than we thought.
Oh, wow.
So making the planet three times larger, which was consistent with a hot Jupiter. And then the secondary made sense there. But it's funny because when I was creating the list of targets to go through, it had the KOI-4 had this really like rough start at first. Like it was initially vetted as like a planet candidate and then later deemed a false positive. And then Jeff Coughlin's RoboVetter was implemented and then it was moved back to a candidate. So had that never happened, I would have never ended up getting it on my list. And it's just kind of like these series of fun, like random things that like just led to the discovery. But if RoboVetter hadn't recharacterized it as a candidate, we would have never found it. And then
Out to my old colleague at Kepler, Jeff Coughlin, and the RoboVetter. Tell us about the announcement of KOI-4.
Yes, yeah, so the actual confirmation of the planet came just a few days before the fourth Kepler Science Conference. So this is, the Kepler mission was still flying then. This is the second from last conference, but I was already basically locked into presenting a poster. And because it was 3 days before, like a good student, I made sure I had my poster printed already.
Right. But it was already done. It was already back from Kinko's. You're ready.
It was nothing about this planet. So what do you do? And, you know, I was so torn because I had this awesome planet discovery, but I already had a poster. So what would any logical person do is just, so you can see right now. So here I am with Dave Latham. Dave Latham is one of the first people to ever find exoplanets. So this was already very exciting for a first year student. Next to my poster and right there to the left of it, you can see this little tiny piece of paper tacked next to it. And if we look at that more closely, you can see that this is the radial velocity curve that was indeed confirming the planet. And I literally hand wrote, thanks to Trace, KOI-4 is now a planet. And then you can see right here, actually, Dave Latham corrected me because it is now technically a confirmed planet. And I still have this piece of paper because, yes, this is why this is will always be the special planet for me.
Yeah, and what a great keepsake to have.
yeah. But the rather exciting part about the confirmation of it was Kepler, the main Kepler mission, had already kind of been repurposed into K2. So it was now staring at the ecliptic. A couple of the wheels broke, so they couldn't stare at that field anymore. And so being the first planet that Kepler ever found, and by the time we were able to publish it, was actually right around the same time Kepler, I think, ran out of fuel. So it's like 10 right. years had passed, and we were just now confirming the first ever planet a decade later. But it was just like this really exciting story to tell as we were all feeling a little bit sad because our favorite little mission was
gone. Yeah.
But I feel like there's so many treasures just still sitting in that data set.
Oh, yeah. No, I mean, when you mentioned that, you know, there was this repurposing or reanalysis of the Kepler data in 2016, I'm like, that is still happening today. People are still reanalyzing the Kepler data and still digging out Kepler planets. You know, this data set, the telescope stopped looking at the Kepler field more than 10 years ago now, and people are still uncovering planets in the Kepler data. So it's the data set that keeps on giving. But it's just such a great story that the very, very first candidate that was ever found by Kepler wasn't confirmed for like a decade and then eventually became Kepler 1658b. So for folks who are unfamiliar with the numbering scheme, that means it was the 1658th planetary system confirmed by Kepler, even though it was the first candidate. But it took, you know, Ashley and Dan's really cool work with astroseismology to solve this puzzle and work out that it really was a confirmed planet. Do you have a favorite real planet? And is it Kepler 1658b?
Yeah, I do have this, but I will always, I mean, there are, I am working on some evolved test systems, and there's, you know, probably about a dozen new systems in there, but I think KY4 will always have a special place in my heart, for sure.
That's right. Your first baby. Yes. Okay, so that's your favorite real planet. Do you have a favorite fictional planet?
Yeah, I really love Pandora. I mean, this is going back a little. Has it already been 20 years? I can't remember.
I think we're getting close. It might be 15 years, like 2008, 2009, I want to say.
Regardless, it was way ahead of its time. Uh-huh. And who doesn't really love floating islands and like riding dragons and, you know, solar eclipses every day? Like, see how excited we get with one solar eclipse every, you know, 18 months, but they get a couple a day, so.
All right, so we're going to talk about more about Pandora from James Cameron's Avatar in the next episode. Please follow us on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. And wherever you're enjoying us, please like us and subscribe or rate and leave a review. So join us next episode to find out more about Ashley's favorite fictional planet, Pandora, and its real-world counterpart. Bye, everyone.
Bye.